I tell you, that opening song was a tough act to follow. Praise team, thank you. Good morning, all.
Good morning.
And they said unto me, come and let us go into the house of the Lord. Aren't you glad to be in the Lord's house this morning?
Yes.
By way of announcements, you'll see an insert in your bulletin, the time and talent card. Listed, you'll find all the ways that the church needs your assistance. There is a spot for everyone. There are many weekly tasks to tasks that will help us grow our membership. If you have any questions about these, call or find Tina, and she'll be able to help you. Also, next Sunday is the fifth Sunday, which means we will be out serving others. Please sign up today on the tear-off portion of your bulletin and let us know how you will be serving so we can ensure we have enough people for each task. These tasks are all once we can perform social distancing. On the same tear-off portion of your bulletin, please mark your attendance and list any prayer concerns so we can be in prayer with you and for you. You can also check off any programs or groups you might like to know more information about, as well as sign up for the sewing class and crafting show. And drop both the tear-off portion and your time and talent card in the offering plate when it comes by later in the service. And now Pastor Greer will lead us in our opening prayer.
Thank you, Brother Jim. Give him a hand. How you feeling this morning? You doing all right?
I'm blessed.
Amen. 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 He had a couple of procedures, and I just think it's wonderful that he's with us this morning. And give his wife a hand for continually taking good care of him. A couple of brief announcements. We have been successful as a COVID testing. Isn't that all right? We've tested almost 100 people here at Zoa. So give yourselves a hand clap of praise for that. Want to thank Ms. Young over at the Your Choice Home Care. They've been our partners, and they're just so bubbly, and they have such a wonderful personality. They fit right in. Briefly, about 5 minutes with the care team, just want to make sure we're all on the same page. If you can meet with me after church, that would be great. Before I open us in prayer, I want to just do something a little lightheartedly. Listen to this. It was this small church. You're paying attention, church. They wanted to do a fundraiser, Olivia, and so Pastor said, well, we're going to do this fundraiser. We want to buy a new piano and get a new piano. And whoever donates the most amount of money get to select three hymns. So everybody said, that sounds exciting. Adora would love a new piano. And so they took up the collection. And as the preacher was looking through the collection, he saw this $100 bill, and he said, wow, we got a winner. So we have a winner, folks. We have a winner. And so he said, whoever gave the $100 bill, come on down. You get to select three hymns. And about along that time, this 80-year-old woman got up, came down to the front of the church. She said, well, the preacher said, you are our winner today, and you get to select your three hymns. And so 80-year-old woman looked out at the audience. She said, I take him, him, and him. Let us pray. Lord, bless us today, and we just thank you for being with us through the COVID, through all the adjustments that we have had to make. Lord, I just thank you for Zoa and the spirit here and the love that we share with each other. Keep us in perfect peace. Bless our homes. And, Lord, edify this service. In your Son, Jesus' name, amen. What do we have? Our congregational hymn. Oh, wow. That's beautiful. 521. Praise team, if you will help us with that.
Please stand if you are able.
If you're able to stand, please stand.
Our first scripture reading comes from Isaiah chapter 62, verses 1 through 5. And you can find that on page 692 in your pew Bible. And whenever you're ready, if you'll say amen. Hear the word of the Lord. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent. And for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her vindication shines out like the dawn and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication and all the kings your glory. And you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and the Lord and the land shall no more be termed desolate. For you shall be called, my delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young woman marries, young man marries a young woman, so shall your builder marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And now if you'll turn in your hymnal to page 771, we'll read our responsive reading, which is Psalm 36, 5 through 10. We will all respond with a response. I'll read the light color print and you'll follow with the bold color print. Okay. I desire to follow your way, O Lord. My God, continue your steadfast love to me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds.
Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your judgments are like the great deep. O Lord, humans and animals you save.
O God, how precious is your steadfast love. All people may take refuge in the shadow of your wings.
They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights.
For with you is the fountain of life. In your light do we see light.
Oh, continue your steadfast love to those who know you, and your salvation to the upright of the heart.
I desire to follow your way, O Lord, my God. Continue your steadfast love to me. Our second scripture reading is found in the book of St. John, chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. I'm going to read from the Common English Bible, and whenever you're ready, if you'll say hallelujah. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks.
If the ushers would come forward. Give them a hand clap of praise as they come. Mike, I don't expect you to gloat every Sunday. You still got your Georgia uniform on. That's true. I'll give you that. Thank you. Well, give the Georgia a hand. That's Georgia, isn't that? Give them a hand clap of praise. It's no easy feat to be national champions. God bless Georgia. Amen. All right. And God bless Georgia Tech and the rest of our great institutions here in Georgia. Amen. All right. All right. That's all right. Raise our offering and let us pray. Lord, we just thank you for the humor that we're able to share in your house of worship. Only because you paid the price and you paid it in full, Lord, and your joy is what we seek. We just thank you for the redemption and restoration. This shalom that you provided us, Lord, it is so that even our finances are restored to their perfect state. Lord, keep the cankerworms from devouring what is ours. And whatever the thief has stolen, return it to us sevenfold, Lord. We just thank you for the members of Zohar and their giving. Continue to gird them up in their time, their talent, and their treasures. Christ, we just thank you for your anointing. Anoint our steps, Lord. Order our steps that we can be steadfast in the ways that we should go. In Jesus' name, amen.
I will sing praise, I will lift my voice, I will sing praise, I've made my choice, I will sing praise in all I do, I will sing praise to you, no matter the storm.
Church, third Sundays, we are going forward. We are going to have laity present, and I think that's good for the edification of the body. This month, we're closing out. We looked at servant leadership, following Christ as we lead people. Next month, we're going to deal with the means of grace. As Methodists, we need to understand the means of grace. We need to understand works of piety and the works of mercy. And Brother Errol King is going to do the message in February. In addition to that, third Sunday, we kind of designated, we have a prayer team, and I just like to, we only have a couple of members, if I'm seeing correctly, Lauren and Juanita. Would you all come and come forward, please? We're kind of laid back, and we want to make sure that we're opening not only the doors of the church, but to be prayed for. So during this pastoral prayer, as they face the audience, if anybody like to be hands laid on, like to be prayed for, you can come down to the front of the pews and we'll be happy to do so. Just give them a hand clap of praise. Every Monday night, we have Lauren, is led by Lauren. We have Catherine and Louis Dillard, Elizabeth, Juanita, myself, and am I missing anybody, Lauren? Judy, definitely Judy, and Joan also. And they've just been faithful for going on a year that the prayers that you sent in to Tina are funded over to us, and each and every person that submit is lined out, and they are definitely prayed for. Come on up, both of you all, and what we're going to do is improvise. I see none, but I want to have you all each to pray for us. Come on, you're going to do the prayer. We'll start with Lauren, and then after that, Sister Juanita will pray. Go right ahead. Just pray for us.
All right, let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this time that we're able to gather, that we are able to be in your presence and to just simply come before you. We know that your word says that you are so happy to hear from us and that you desire and that you love to hear from us, and that when two or more are gathered in your name, your spirit is among us. And Lord, with that, I just lift us up to you, and I just pray for healing, for peace and comfort, for challenges that people are going through, both with family members, friends, or themselves. Lord, please guide us and direct us each day so that we may be lights in this community and bring you joy and honor and glory to your kingdom.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you again that today is the day that you have made, and thank you for making us a part of this day, creating us a clean heart, renew within us the right spirit. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you, Father, because every day belongs to you, and each day you allow us to be a part of it. We are grateful and thankful. Create in us more of you. Let us die to the flesh and the spirit rise up in us. We need you in everything that we do. And we just thank you that the Holy Spirit, you lead, guide, and direct us as we need in everything that we do. We need wisdom. We need knowledge. We need understanding, good communication. We thank you for friends and loved ones. We thank you for the men and women of God, Father, the ones you have placed in the ministry to carry forth the word of God, that, Father, we not only be hearers but doers. So as we're called upon to do whatever you ask us to do, let us do it with grateful hearts. Let us do it exceedingly glad because, Father, it's your work, and your work will be carried out. So we thank you for each and every one that is here, whatever's going on in their bodies, or if they're not feeling the greatest, that you heal them, you give them a special touch. Father, because we know that our healing comes from the Lord. We look to the hills from which cometh thy help, for all our help comes from you. And we pray for all of our Zoa family, Father, that they continually to walk by faith and not by sight. We thank you today for our pastor and the overseer of this church. And we pray your will be done. We give you the praise, honor, and glory. As my sister have said, bless this nation. Bless the people who are standing in need of peace, love, joy, healing, all the necessities. We pray they will be met. And we give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Just wanted to hear these prayer warriors. Give them a hand clap of praise. Thank you. All of you. Well, we have some special music. This is a beautiful song also. And Brother Terry really need no introduction around here, but want to acknowledge his wife. Wave your hand out there. Amen. And we're just delighted to have him. And his mother was so dear to this church, and we just love their family, and God bless them all. So after this beautiful song, the next voice you will hear will be the man that's going to break the bread of life. God bless him. Go right ahead.
Is heaven to me. Good morning, church. I greet you in the matchless name of Jesus Christ, the one who was and is to come, our Lord, our Savior, and our soon coming King. They were just singing about Jesus. The Cajuns, the folks down in South Louisiana, have a word, and it's called, it's langnap. I'm not pronouncing it right, I'm sure. Probably comes from the French. But what that word means is a little something extra. So what I'm about to give you now is not part of the message. It's a little something extra. We're just singing about Jesus. So I want you to think about who he is. And I want to read what Paul says about him. And this is kind of a springboard to the message because Paul is trying to call the Corinthian church back to this. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authority, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in him and through him to reconcile himself to all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Amen. Amen. That's in Colossians, by the way, first chapter. Now, Paul was talking to the Corinthian church, and I'll be taking these things on and off. Hope that doesn't distract you, but when I put them on, I'm needing to see something down there. But if I take them off, I'm in spirit, I hope. Paul was talking to the Corinthian church. The Corinthian church was a mess. Anybody ever heard of a church being in a mess?
No.
Oh, yeah. Churches are populated by people, and people get in messes. Well, a Corinthian church was in a major mess. Paul had established the church on one of his missionary journeys, and they'd started off good, like a lot of churches do, but they had wandered away, and they had begun to put things and people and place and all kinds of things above Jesus, who is supreme, Paul says. So here they were. All kind of sexual immorality, sin. They were abusing the gifts of the Holy Spirit. They were dipping a little too much in the communion wine to the point of being drunk. They were doing all kinds of things. And Paul got wind of this, so he sat down and wrote them this letter. And he had just been through, in the first couple of chapters of 1 Corinthians, he talks a little bit about what's going on in the church. And then he spends a good bit of time giving correction and teaching about how things should be done in the church. And he had just got through talking about the Spirit and the movement of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and so on and so forth. And he says in the 31st verse of chapter 12 in 1 Corinthians, he says, seek the best gifts, but I will show you the most excellent way. The most excellent way. What is the most excellent way, you might ask? Love is the most excellent way. And who or what does the Bible say is love? God. You can look that up if you want to. It's 1 John 4:8, 1 John 4:16. Back in the Jesus music movement, we used to sing a little song, Beloved, let us love one another. And that's, if I start singing it, I'm sure that the dogs will be howling somewhere on Zor Church Road. But anyway, that's very important to understand. God is love. Right? Everybody with me so far? Well, I don't know about you, but every time I think about the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians, I think about a wedding. Don't you? Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth, says in the verses 4 through 6 in chapter 13. We even call it the love chapter, and we prescribe it for virtually every Christian wedding in every church, regardless of their denomination or affiliation, be they liturgical, be they Pentecostal, it don't matter. You'll hear this said over and over again, quoted over and over again. Paul says in the first two verses, he says, if I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. There was a rock and roll singer that got saved by the name of Larry Norman. And one of his most popular songs was, Without Love, You Ain't Nothing. And that's basically what Paul is saying here. Without love, you ain't nothing. Well, I would submit to y'all that this is a terrific piece of literature, much less scripture. I mean, it's just beautiful. But I suspect that old Paul, every time he hears these words reduced to an ecclesiastical equivalent of icing on a conjugal cake, he probably winces just a little bit. He doesn't set out here merely to offer advice to the matrimonially minded. He's instead trying to get at something that is far broader and deeper in the Christian life. And the implications of it carry over not just in life in this building, but life in the world. What's he trying to get at? He's trying to get at love. Love is the foundation. Without love, spirituality becomes meaningless. 1 Corinthians 12, 31b and then 13. And now I will show you the most excellent way. And if I can turn this page. Russell, you preached all them years. Did you ever have trouble with this? The pages turning? That's a smart man. See, he pastored over 40 years, so that's a trick I'll have to try to remember. Let's get back to it here. Paul said, if I speak with the tongue of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all the mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. And it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there's knowledge, it will pass away. For now we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish things behind me. Now we see but a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Without love, gifted and ecstatic speech is just noise. If I speak in the tongue of men and of angels, but I have not love, I'm basically just making noise. I'm clanging cymbals and rattling chains and whatever. I'm not doing anything of value because I don't have love. Paul is here, of course, referring to tongues, and that particular gift of the Spirit had been abused terribly by the Corinthian church. But he's also talking about the gift of eloquent speech, the ability to stand before a group of people or in a small setting or three or four or even one-on-one and talk to folks beautifully and powerfully. Both of these things, tongues and the ability of eloquent speech, were very highly prized by the Corinthian church. I'm going to have to remember that turn down the page thing. Without love, great faith and knowledge are meaningless. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. The gifts that Paul mentions in this particular passage in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians appear to involve a much deeper faith than just something on the surface. Paul is speaking of those who understand the mysteries of God and who are able to speak prophetically to the church. Now, that's not necessarily talking about seeing the future. What I'm doing right now is prophesying. I'm telling forth. So those that have the ability to prophesy or speak prophetically to the church or have faith enough to move mountains or to heal the sick, they're experiencing God's power really in impressive ways in their lives, right? Nevertheless, without love, even such great understanding and power is brought to nothing. Without love, self-sacrifice is not pleasing to God. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. In the same way, self-sacrifice, whether of possessions or one body, without love, is meaningless. This last item seems a little bit counterintuitive to me, since self-sacrifice seems to, by definition, be an act of love, doesn't it? However, the act of sacrificing ourselves for others or of giving up our possessions for others or even for God is not always motivated by concern for others, is it? Sometimes it's motivated by the desire to draw attention to ourselves. This is the point Paul is trying to make concerning spirituality without love. Spirituality can be motivated by pride, by self-righteousness, by the desire to meet some goal, by the desire to appear spiritual before men. In such case, self-sacrifice, impressive though it may be, is meaningless. And I submit, is even absurd without love. Here's the question, love's question. This understanding of spiritual behavior as absurd without love ought to get our attention. There's a very real danger of acting spiritual and appearing spiritual and in doing spiritual things without stopping and asking ourselves why we're doing them. According to Paul, spirituality without love is dead. Just like old James says over in the second chapter, works without faith is dead. Or faith without works is dead, both ways. To show the love of God and for others ought to be the goal of our spiritual practice, of how we live our lives as believers. We ought to ask ourselves, why do we do what we do? And be willing when God confronts us through the Holy Spirit with our false motivations. And the Lord knows I have had plenty of them and still do from time to time. Love is our discipleship and the obedience we must learn. And lack of love must be confronted. As we dive deeper into 1 Corinthians 13, it becomes increasingly clear to me that Paul hasn't stopped in the middle of his letter that he's writing, which is a letter of correction from a pastor to a body of believers. He is pretty much laying down the law to them and saying, you know, kind of waving his finger at him, his spiritual finger, saying, look, y'all are out of line. And I just don't think he stopped in the middle of that to write this love letter, some nice poetry. I just don't think so. This is not a nice, flowery poem meant only to be read at weddings. In fact, I think it's a brutal, pastoral, spirit-led confrontation of the church at Corinth. And if we read it properly and seek to understand it properly, it is the same for us. Let's look at verses 4 through 7 right quick. Love is patient and kind, unlike the Corinthians who were divisive and fighting among themselves. Love is not envious, unlike the Corinthians who were jealous and quarreling. Love is not boastful, but the Corinthians are. He spends the whole first, really the whole first 11, 12 chapters of the letter talking about how boastful they are and the things that they're doing out of boasting, out of a fleshly boast. Love is not puffed up, but the Corinthians are. In fact, it's the Corinthians' knowledge or their perceived knowledge of spiritual things that has them puffed up. Love is not rude or shameful. But the Corinthians have acted shamefully. There's open incest in the church at Corinth. And women are dressing and wearing their hair like the shrine prostitutes at the temples, the pagan temples there in Corinth. And men and women both are getting drunk at communion. So they're not only rude, they are shameful, but love is not. Love is not self-seeking. But the Corinthians have been self-seeking in the area of spiritual freedoms. Chapter 10, verse 24. Love is not easily angered, nor does it keep a record of wrongs. But the Corinthians are angry with one another. They're breaking fellowship, and then they're dragging Paul into it. They're bringing all their accusations against each other with Paul. They're writing letters to Paul. They're sending people to talk to Paul about what somebody else in the church is or isn't doing. Love does not rejoice in evil, but rejoices in good. But the Corinthians, they were happily and self-righteously doing harm to one another and not seeming to care too much about it. Love always protects, always trusts, always perseveres. Where the Corinthians were at war with each other. And at war with God, really. All of these things characterize the church at Corinth. And if you look at that in context, it becomes evident to me, at least, that Paul's not given marital instruction here. Although the same principles, those of us that are married, the same principles apply. But he's talking about the character and lifestyle demanded of the church. Logically, then, Paul's argument runs this way. Without love, even the greatest acts of spirituality become absurd and meaningless gestures, showing nothing of the true nature of Christ. And the Corinthian community has not, in any way, shown even a hint of the love of Christ to each other, much less the community of Corinth in total. What's the demand of love then? The connotations are very clear. A church which does not love, which is not characterized by love for one another and for the community therein, is a helpless, useless, absurd church. An individual in the church, regardless of their gifts, their calling, their place, their outward sacrifice, who can't live the life of love accomplishes nothing. Don't get mad at me, get mad at Paul. Unless we're willing to keep no record of wrongs toward one another, to have a very long fuse on our temper, to be patient and kind with one another, to refrain from self-seeking behavior, the community of the church can't be a powerful witness for God in this world. Gifts, in and of themselves, can't build up the body. If they're in operation properly and in order, they do build up the body. But in and of themselves, they can't. There has to be an order of things. God is a God of order. He's not a God of chaos. If there's chaos, you can just about bet God's not involved in it. He's standing on the side with his arms crossed looking sort of askance. What do they think they're doing? Without love, we can't truly come to know the spiritual life that we're supposed to live in God by the Spirit for Jesus. We just can't. Love is our hope. Love is the end toward which we labor. Only love is lasting. Why spend, I don't know how long I've been talking, 15 minutes, 10 minutes? Why spend all this time on love? Why did Paul spend all this time on love? Verse 8 tells us very clearly, love never fails. And who or what is love? God. Somebody said it. God never fails, because God is love. The basis of our redemption is the fact that God has set his love loose on us, and he loves us. The basis of our discipleship is that God loves us and that we're responding to him in love. The basis of the church is that we're a group of those called out of this world of self-centeredness and hatred. Through the shed blood of Jesus, we've entered into a community of those people who love God. And because we love God and we're loved by God, we should love one another as a family ought to do. And we should love the community in which we have been placed, which God has planted us. The basis of our hope is that we will live forever with God, whom we love, rather than being separated from him. Where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. In sharp contrast to love, giftedness will come to an end. Prophecy, teaching, preaching, dare I say it, leading, helping others, tongues, knowledge, all of those things are temporary, given to the church for the period between the first and second coming of Christ. Those gifts are temporary. Only love will bring us to a full knowledge of God. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put away childish things. Now we see but a poor reflection. I like the way the King James says it. Now we see as though through a glass, darkly. Then we'll see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know full, just as I am fully known. More importantly, I think the gifts are only partial in their usage. The ability to know truth, to prophesy, to discern, to understand mysteries, to heal, to teach and preach, all of these gifts can only bring us to a dim awareness of the glory of God. Think about the passage out of Colossians that I read out of the first chapter of Colossians. That's the glory of God Paul's talking about there. He describes it so beautifully. One of my favorite passages. I said one day I'd commit it to memory, and then while I was thinking about doing that, I got a little bit older. And now those things don't come as easy as they did when I was younger. Oh, we only know in part now. Our prophetic speaking, our preaching, is only a partial expression. We're like children with our gifts. We're too immature to understand the realities we claim to know. And like children, we're confident that we know what we say we know. But when we come to know fully, when we arrive at that place and look back, we're going to have a good chuckle at ourselves and our small understandings of the things of God. So therefore, the gifts and our understandings need to be taken seriously, but not too seriously. That's what the church in Corinth was doing. They was taking it to the extreme. Now, these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. We're to realize that love, the expression of the true nature of Jesus, is much more important than knowing or abilities or great experiences. So the question we should be asking ourselves, if we're serious about this discipleship thing, this leadership thing, because I submit to you that you cannot lead without love. You can't do it. What does the pastor always says? I love you and ain't nothing you can do about it. How am I doing with this love thing? That's the question we need to be asking ourselves. Here are some questions which should characterize our thinking when we come to discipleship and leadership within the church and even without the church inside the community. In what ways am I expressing love to other believers and to non-believers in our community? In what ways do verses 4 through 7 convict me? Love is patient and kind. Am I? Love is not envious. Am I? Love is not boastful. Am I? Love is not puffed up. Am I? Love is not rude or shameful. Am I? Love is not self-seeking. Am I? Love is not easily angered, nor does it keep a record of wrongs. Do I? Love does not rejoice in evil, but rejoices in truth. Do I? Love always protects, always trusts, always perseveres. Do I? What would it mean practically for me to always protect and always hope and always preserve in love, for persevere in love for others in the community? Not only in this community of believers, but in the community global. In light of our answers to those questions I just posed, how is God calling us to obediently respond to 1 Corinthians chapter 13? And I'm going to close with this. Now, I'm a layman. I'm not a pastor. So when I say I'm going to close with this, it means I'm going to close with this. When a pastor says that, it don't mean nothing. Just like when they take their watch off and put it up here, it don't mean nothing either. I want to leave you up to this thought. And the thought is this: always, 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 Pastor, always lead with love. Why? Because love never fails. May God bless you as you read and study His Word.
give our praise team a hand clap of praise. Let them know that you love them. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Brother Freeman, the most excellent way. Amen. You know, when you talk about love in a Christian church, sometimes it seems like it falls on deaf ears because we do realize that there's a cruel world out there. Somebody say amen. That there are some evil people in this world. And so, yes, you got to love, but I just admonish you that when you go out through those doors, make sure you have the whole armor of God on. Say amen. Don't you be out there fighting without a helmet, without a sword or a breastplate, talking about love, because they'll chew you up and spit you out. But when you're among your family, your church family, you ought to be practicing love. And that's just getting yourself out of the way and judging righteousness, not because of your own, which is why our Father in heaven sent his only begotten Son. He first loved us. So you need to first love somebody else. Say amen. Love ye one another as Christ loved us is my mission. So glory to God. We here at Zoa, whether you're looking at us virtually or you in person or you've been thinking about a church home, we just like to open our doors. And that is the foundation that we build on. We're ordinary people doing extraordinary things for the Lord. Reconciling souls back unto the Father through Jesus Christ and the power of his Holy Spirit. That is love. That's love that's in the community. So we ask you in 2022, we need your corporate sponsorship. We need your bodies. We need you to come with your time, your talent, and your treasures. But yes, we want like-minded Christians, right? We want Christians that's going to come and find a place at the Lord's table. It belongs to the Lord. Come as you are, and we'll love you just as you are. But now, will you come as you are, but through the walk and accountability of Christ, we expect every Christian to get better. Say amen. You ought to be better this year than you were last year. It may take this much to make you mad this year, whereas last year, it took that much. You ought to be getting better at this thing called life through love. Amen? So we definitely want you to come, and we look forward to your membership this year. We're hoping for some baptism. We're hoping a full year in the name of the Lord. With that said, give yourselves a hand clap of praise. Give our audio team a hand clap of praise that is going out, and we're averaging about 100 people, and people are viewing us this way, and we love you and thank God for you. Give our ushers a hand clap of praise. Brother Jim Hope, great job. Give Terry another hand. And just say hello to my sugar lump. She's still taking care of me. I love her, and I thank God for her. She's a wonderful, wonderful person. Everybody got through the holidays okay. We're feeling good there, right? 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 And the Omicron, it looks like it's going down, so there's hope. But don't get anxious. We're just going to be steadfast, which is your word for the week. I want you to just be steadfast in your steps, steadfast in your love, steadfast in your giving, and steadfast in your ways of Christ. With that said, please stand. Receive this parting blessing. Did you have a good time today? Yes, it's hard, but it's fair. We are called to love ye one another as Christ loved us. That's the heart of the matter. That is the heart of the matter. Receive this, please. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work, to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Trifold amen, please.